Well, as many of y'all know, Anna is going to be giving her testimony this morning. And some of you may have wondered, where is Anna? I don't see her. She's in the nursery. I think on purpose, but that's okay. Because we recorded her testimony because I really believe it's something that we need to hear, something that God wants to work through and work in us through. It's not going to be able to happen live. So so if you guys, it's on iTunes back there. If you will, if you'll go ahead and start that, we're just going to just kind of sit, and there's going to be nothing on the screen. It might be a little weird for us because we're so used to being constantly stimulated, but I think it might be good for us. We're just going to listen and just hear what God has to say through her. And then it's only about 6 or 7 minutes, and then we'll get up and we'll teach through a passage of scripture for a minute too. So Lynn, if you go ahead and set that up for us.
So my story is totally different than a lot of testimonies that I heard growing up. I always thought that to have a good testimony, that it needed to involve a tragic event that God saved you from. So since mine was not like that at all, I always felt that my story wasn't worth sharing. I would always hide in the back of youth group as people shared and hope that I could fly under the radar and not be asked to speak. So when Jason asked me to share my testimony, I had a small panic attack. I can speak in front of a group of kids all day long, but am terrified to speak in front of adults. And as many of my closest friends know, I have a closet full of turtlenecks and scarves that I have to wear for my parent conferences at school because I turn beet red when I talk in front of others. Just typing this at home is causing me to break out, thinking of Jason reading it out loud. So now that you know my most embarrassing feature, here's my story. I grew up in a strong Christian family. My dad often served in our church, and my mom was, and still is, my biggest prayer warrior. They not only taught me about Christ, but they lived out how to be a Christian in their daily lives. In fact, the main reason I became a teacher is because I grew up going with my mom to drop off my used clothes at the homes of the students that she taught that were in need. I would watch the faces of those kids light up, and I knew I wanted to make an impact like that when I grew up. My dad taught me to stand strong and to work hard. His favorite phrase was dig in deep. When hard times and trials came up, I learned from an early age that I could trust God to bring me through the trials I faced. Now, I'm not saying that my family was perfect. My parents had fights, and my brother and I didn't always get along, and things were not always easy. But we loved each other and always worked things out. My grandparents on both sides were Christians as well. My grandfather made one of the biggest impacts on me. He always had his Bible next to his chair, and the cover was worn out. The pages were fragile, and I knew that it was used daily. My grandfather had a massive stroke, and it caused lots of damage to his vocal cords. In fact, he had to learn how to talk again. He had only a few phrases that he would say. But one day we visited for lunch and we started to pray before the meal. As we began to pray, another voice chimed in and we all grew silent. We all listened as my grandfather stuttered through the prayer out loud. I remember that we all just stood there with tears streaming down our faces. That was the only time he did the prayer, and he never really spoke much at all after that. But I was amazed at the fact that of all the things he chose to ever say again, he chose to pray to his father. I'm thankful still for these early influences in my life. Even though I grew up in a Christian family and had attended church every time the doors were open, I still remember the day I realized that my good works were just not enough. When I was in fourth grade, our church had a guest speaker named David Ring visit. David Ring is a man that was born with cerebral palsy. He struggles to speak, and yet he's allowing God to use him in spite of the obstacles he faces. I remember that the phrase he spoke on was, "Quit your belly aching." He had a joy and peace like I had never seen before. He had every reason in life to be frustrated and to want to give up, but he showed such an excitement for life. It was then that I realized that his faith and trust in Jesus was what changed his outlook, and that I wanted that in my life too. I wanted to be more than just a good girl. I wanted to begin a relationship with a God that could give me that joy and peace that I saw in David. I remember talking to my parents that I wanted to go down to the front after he was done speaking and talk with someone, but I didn't want to walk down the aisle alone. At that age, the aisle seemed to be a mile long. My dad looked at me and said, "If that's something you really desire, then you can be brave and walk down on your own." At that moment, I began to slowly make my way down to the front. At the front was my fourth grade teacher, smiling, and she was the one to talk with me and help me understand how to be saved. I'm so thankful now that my parents had me do this on my own. In the moment, I was terrified, but now I can look back and know in my heart that accepting Christ was a decision I made. It wasn't based on an emotional high, or because my parents said it was time, or because my best friend went down in tears and I felt the need to join her. I know that God opened my heart that day and showed me what a relationship with Him could look like, and I am so thankful that He loves me so much that He pursued me that day. I was blessed with a great youth group and some amazing Christian friends, many of whom I still talk and pray with today. I never stayed out partying or got drunk or did drugs. In fact, Jason was my first official boyfriend. He was even my first kiss. I used to think I was so lame because I had never dated until college, but I realize now that God protected me from so much pain. I'm so thankful for His guidance and protection in my life as I grew up. I do want to be clear that as a pastor's wife, I am not immune to problems. I have temptations and challenges that I face daily. Even though my struggles may not be visible for others to see, I still have sin that I deal with each day. I still have insecurities and feel the need to be included and loved. And though I may not turn to drugs or alcohol to solve those problems, I still am in need of a Savior that can help me walk through my struggles. I'm reading a book now called Uninvited by Lisa Turkhurst. I have found a quote that I have decided to cling to when I do face uncertainties, and it is this: God is always at work. He is a present, loving Father, aware of our deepest hurts and our even deeper needs. We aren't always able to see this clearly. Still, even when it seems otherwise, we must remember that sometimes when we feel rejected and passed over for someone else, when God seems busy elsewhere or even purposefully unmoving, the truth is, He's at work, maybe doing something entirely beyond what we were thinking. I'm thankful that God has placed us here at Bridge 42, and I can't wait to see what He has in store for our church. I love that I can be real here and that I have friends that love me despite all my quirks. I love doing life with all of you, and I can't wait to see how all of our past stories will be used to reach others. And by the way, if you're ever out shopping and see a really cute scarf or a turtleneck, let me know. I always can use more of those in my life.
I really wanted Anna to share that because I think that's a testimony that we don't get to hear as often. You know, so often we hear, and there's great value in these testimonies, but we hear these testimonies where, you know, this guy was in such a dark place, and he had a gun in one hand and a Bible in the other, and then it was like, you know, and there's value in that. We see what God can bring you out of and what God can rescue you from. But I think also when we see testimonies, one of the things Anna used to say all the time, I don't have a very good testimony, as if, you know, that was your job, was to you know, come up with the best testimony, you know, live the worst. You hear that phrase, you know, people say, I'm working on my testimony, you know. And but I disagree. I mean, I think this idea that one, that God can not just rescue you from pain like that, but can actually keep you from it, can order your life in such a way that, because it's grace. That's grace too. It's not that Anna did something so much better than somebody else. That's grace. That was an extension of God's grace to her, that she was allowed to be spared from some of that stuff. And then also, and I think this is so necessary, especially in this part of the world. You know, I grew up in upstate New York. I grew up an unchurched kid in a very unchurched part of the world, and somehow God found me, and I heard the gospel, and I came to Christ, even in that situation. But in this area, it seems like we kind of have almost the opposite problem, where there's so many people that are like, oh yeah, I grew up in church, you know, I prayed a prayer, I got baptized, I'm good, right? I'm good, you know? And I think what we see through Anna's story and through the passage of scripture that we're going to look at this morning is that that's not necessarily the case. That we are all in need of grace, we are all in need of mercy, we are all in need of the sacrifice that Jesus made for us on the cross. No matter how well we have lived our life, no matter how many good works we have done, no matter how many sins we have managed to avoid, we all are flawed, we all fall short, and we all are in need of the grace and the mercy that only Jesus can offer us. So we're going to look this morning in Luke chapter 15. Starting in verse 11, this is a story that many of you are probably very familiar with. It's actually, I was doing some reading on it this week, and it's actually considered to be the third most well-known Bible story. Behind the Christmas story and behind the story of the Good Samaritan, this story that we typically call the prodigal son or the lost son is probably the third most well-known story in all of Scripture. So let's go ahead and read this together. Luke 15, verse 11, it says, and he said, Jesus said, there was a certain man who had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of property that's coming to me. And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all that he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into his fields to feed pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger. I will arise, and I will go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. And he arose and went to his father, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe, put it on him, put a ring on his hand, put shoes on his feet, bring in the fattened calf and kill it. And let's celebrate. For this, my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. Now his older son was in a field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, your brother has come and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has received him back safe and sound. But he was angry, the older brother was angry, and refused to go in. And his father came out and entreated him. But he answered his father, look, these many years I have served you. I've never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him. And he said to him, son, you are always with me. All that is mine is yours. But it was fitting to celebrate and be glad. For this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found. Father, just help us this morning as we study your word together. Just help us to understand, to believe the things that it promises us and to put them into practice. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So this is, like I said, probably the third most well-known story in all of Scripture. It's one of the most well-known stories that Jesus told. There are entire books that have been written about it. There are literally probably dozens, maybe hundreds of songs that have written about at least the ideas in this story. And there's just all kinds of material out there. There's been probably millions, I don't know, maybe that's a bit of an exaggeration, but tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of sermons preached and Bible studies done on this story. But none of them, except one book by Tim Keller that I found recently, none of them has ever really tried to answer what I think is one of the most pressing questions about this passage. One of the questions that this passage brings up that we don't think about very often. Most of us, we probably know about the younger son, right? We know how much of an insult it would have been for the son to go to the father and say, I want my inheritance before the father's even dead, to go and say, I want, we know that would be an insult. We know how degrading it would be for a young Jewish man to be living in a far country and be taking care of pigs, an animal that the Israelite people thought was unclean. We know how degrading it would be. We know how much he must have been suffering if he was considering eating the food that these unclean animals were eating. And we know, many of us, how it was considered dishonorable for a wealthy man to run. So when the father ran to him, how much this father put himself out for this son who had dishonored him in this way. And he's running, he's leaving his dignity and his honor behind and running to his son. We most of us have an idea about the importance that of the fact that the Father, you know, came, and he didn't ask him any questions. He didn't force him to give an account for his actions. He didn't wonder where the money, he just took him back. He said, "My son was dead and he's alive, and I'm not going to have you as a servant anymore." Did you catch that? Where the son says, "I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Just make me one of your hired servants." And what does the father say? Like, he didn't even say it. "Oh, my son has returned home." We know about that, how the father received him back in a way that he didn't deserve. We've heard this. And we've even heard some about the older brother. But here's the question that I never really got the answer for until I read Tim Keller's book, Prodigal God. It's a short little book. It's like 120 pages that Tim Keller wrote about this story. It's really, if you get a chance to read it, it's definitely worth the read. If you don't, and most of what I'm saying here is taken out of it anyways, plagiarized out of it anyways. So, no, read it, because it's better than what I'm going to say, I'm sure. J.D. Greer, who's one of my favorite pastors to plagiarize, says that Tim Keller is one of his favorite pastors to plagiarize. So, so here's the question. Here's the question that nobody really wants to answer. What ended up happening to the older brother? Anybody ever wondered that before? What happened to the older brother? Because at the end of the story, he's refusing to come in. The father comes out, says, "Come in. This is right. This is good that we should celebrate." The older brother says, "No, I'm not gonna do it." The father makes one last appeal. "Your son, your brother was lost, and now he's found. Come in, join the party, celebrate," and the story is over. We don't find out what happened to the older brother. We know about his jealousy. We know about his legalistic attitude, but we don't know how does the story end up. What does the brother end up doing? So why don't we find out? Well, there's a couple of thoughts maybe in this. Maybe the older brother isn't really that important to the story. Maybe the story's really about the younger son. You know, a lot of times when we hear this story talked about or written about, the focus is kind of on the younger son. A lot of times, like testimonies, you know, we have the focus on, you know, Anna's probably not going to get on the Christian speaking circuit and make lots of money going around telling her testimony like the guy who you know, did drugs and all this, had all this crazy stuff happen, you know? And so we kind of focus on the younger son. But I don't think he's a side note. And I think if you look at Scripture, what we may find out is that the older brother may be more of a focus than the younger brother is. If you look back with me, and look at the context of where this story is, what we see is this follows two other stories about something that was lost and is found. It's the story of the lost coin and the story of the lost sheep. In the story of the lost coin, this woman, she has 10 coins, she loses one, she puts the 9 aside and turns the house upside down looking for the one, And then she finds it, and she throws a big party for all her friends to celebrate, probably spending more money than what she had originally lost. But we see the rejoicing. It says there's rejoicing in heaven over just one sinner who comes to repentance. And then there's the story of the lost sheep, where a shepherd has 100 sheep. He loses one. Then he risks the lives of the other 99 to leave them and go off and find this one lost sheep. And when he finds it, he brings it back, and there is rejoicing. And Jesus says there's more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who comes to repentance than over 99 righteous who need no repentance. And so we see here, and then that's the context in which he tells this story. And in fact, when he starts off the story in verse 11, it says, "And he said, there was a man who had two sons." That Greek word "said" is not just like he was talking, or it's a specific word, it's a specific kind of speech. It's the Greek word lego. Everybody said lego. Lego. And the root of that word originally meant to lay down to sleep. So to lay like a baby down to sleep. You would lego the baby, you would lay the baby down to sleep. And it eventually came to mean putting an argument to rest. So Jesus this isn't just casual speech. He's putting this argument to rest. He's having the definitive word on a matter. So what argument is Jesus putting to rest? He's putting to rest this conversation that he's having about that there's more joy in heaven over one sinner who comes to repentance than over 99 who need no repentance. So if the older brother maybe the focus of the story, why don't we find out what happens to him? If he is at least as important as the younger brother, if not more important to the story than the younger brother, why don't we find out how he ends up? Well, I'm glad you asked. Right. Thank you, Martha. Here's the key. We go back to verse 1. Before the beginning of this speech, before he's told any of these stories, we go back to Luke chapter 15, verse 1. It says, now the tax collectors and the sinners were all drawing near to hear him. So these are younger brother types. They've not lived their life maybe the way that they should have. And then verse 2, it says, and the Pharisees and the scribes, we already said that the older brother was kind of legalistic and like a Pharisee. The Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, this man receives sinners and eats with him. And then verse 3, and then it says that Jesus begins to speak to them. So who is Jesus speaking to? I mean, he's trying to speak to the tax collectors and sinners. That was his original audience. They had gathered because they wanted to hear what he had to say. But this is all getting interrupted by these Pharisees and these scribes that are grumbling. Like, he eats with sinners. He's hanging out with sinners, man. I mean, just go off and do their tax collecting and their sinning somewhere else, you know? And so Jesus is trying to speak to the tax collectors, but the Pharisees and the religious leaders show up and they start grumbling. And so I think he's addressing, and I think the passage bears this out, he's addressing the Pharisees and the religious leaders. And that's the key. We don't yet know how the Pharisaical older brother is going to react because it's up to them. This story is an invitation. He's talking to these Pharisees and he's giving them an invitation. He's telling them a story that if they would listen and if they would pay attention and if they would let God's Spirit work in their hearts and their minds, they would see themselves in. They would see themselves as standing outside the door while the tax collectors and the sinners, they're rejoicing over them because they're coming home. They're coming to Jesus. And they would see themselves. They would see the Father coming out and welcoming and encouraging them to come back into the party. And it's an invitation. So why doesn't Jesus tell us what happens? Because it's not really been decided yet. It's an invitation. It's up to these religious leaders. Jesus is speaking directly to these religious leaders, and I think he's speaking directly to some of us this morning. This story is the other side of grace. This is the side of grace that sometimes makes some of us feel a bit uncomfortable. Because grace is available to everyone. And we like that. And you're like, I'm with you. That means it's available to you. Yeah, I'm with you. Grace is available to me. No matter what I've done, no matter where I've been, grace is available to me. That means it's available to your enemies. You know, wait a minute. You had me for a second there. It's available to the person that hurt you. It's available to the person that tried to do harm to your family. It's available to the guy who has wasted his life apart from Christ. It's available to the person that wants to hurt you and your family. It's available to the vilest offender. It's available to the most despicable person you can imagine. It's available to all of us. Do you believe that this morning? Do you believe that grace is open to everyone? Even your enemy, even the worst criminal, even the Muslim terrorist. Are you okay with that this morning? And it's even more than that. Look at verse 21 and verse 22. It says, and the son said to him, now the son's coming back, right? He's practiced his speech. He said, I will go to my father. I will say, I'm no longer worthy to be your son. Make me as one of your hired servants. And he goes back in verse 21. And the son said to his father, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe and put it on him and put the ring. Did anybody notice something in that was different than the way that he had practiced it? The father cut him off, right? When he's practicing it in verse 19, he says, I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. Verse 21, he says, I am no longer worthy to be called your son. And then the father jumps in, he's like, oh, no, I'm not hearing this. I'm not having this. My son has come back. One of my hired servants didn't come back. My son has come back. The father cuts him off before he could even finish his speech because honestly, it's not important. Now, I'm not saying repentance isn't important. Repentance is tremendously important. The son has repentance. The fact that the son even showed up shows that he has repentance. But the depth of his regret, the articulation of his repentance. Has anybody ever wondered, like, you know it's not true, but on some level in the back of your head, there's that little voice that was saying, you know, if you could pray a little better, if you could sound a little sorrier when you pray, maybe God would forgive you more, you know, maybe God would be more likely to forgive you. The articulation of your repentance does not matter. You come before God and you lay down and you, you know, all you can get out is, sorry. That's repentance. Amen. It's your heart. That's what matters. It's not important. He's back. He's returned. And some of us struggle with that. Some of us struggle with that with ourselves and some of us struggle with that with others. Well, you know, they didn't sound that sorry. You ever caught yourself thinking that before? Oh, I've heard that before. People like that, you know, they're never going to change. But God's love says, my son has returned. Kill the fattened calf. Get a ring. Get a robe. We're going to celebrate. We're going to honor him. I know what he did, but we're going to honor him because he's my son. I wonder, are you bothered when somebody's sorrow doesn't quite seem deep enough? When their regret doesn't quite seem to match the darkness in their life. I wonder if that bothers some of us this morning. Because it doesn't bother Grace. Remember back when I was first leading worship here, this was, gosh, like 2008 maybe? It's a long time ago. Back when I was first leading worship here, I was telling an older pastor in the community about what was going on in the church. We were going through some hard times at that. We had like 50 people coming on Sunday mornings, and it was rough. A few of y'all might remember that, and anybody want to go back to that? I'm good, you know. But I remember telling this gentleman that that I think God was working in our situation. I know our budget was hurting, and we were, you know, getting to the point where something didn't happen. We might have to think about closing the doors, and but I said, I think God's still working. I think God, I told him this, you know, something to the effect of, I think God might be allowing us to be brought to a low place so that we can become a church that begins to reach out to people who are at a low place in life. Because there's so many people that don't feel like they fit in some of this. So many people, I talk to people all the time, they're like, well, you know, I'm just not the kind of person that belongs in church. Really? Have you read the New Testament? Because like, there isn't that kind of person in Scripture that doesn't belong in church, right? And I said, I think that maybe God's allowing us to be brought low so that we would be willing and able to reach out to those who feel like they don't belong, who feel like they don't have a place, and who feel like they're in a low place in life. And he looked at me and he said, Jason, you know, that's great, but the problem with that is you can't really build a solid foundation for your church with those kinds of people. And then he talked some more. I don't honestly remember what he said because I blocked everything out after that. And I get, on some level, I get what he's saying. I understand that it's going to be hard. If my goal is to build this great church and have a nice big paycheck, then maybe that's not the way to do it. And I get that maybe offerings are going to be low, and I get that maybe I'm going to have to deal with stuff that most of my pastor friends don't get the privilege of dealing with. You know, on some level, that pastor's probably right a little bit. You know, it's going to be hard. I don't know how it's going to end up. But I intend to find out. And if you guys are with me on this, then I'd like to find that out together. And basically, that's the invitation in this story. Come and join the party. I know it doesn't make sense. I know what he's done. I know where he's been. But this son of mine, whom I love, your brother. Did you catch that? The brother said about the party. He didn't say, and this brother of mine returns. He said, no, this son of yours returns home. This son, your brother, has come home. I know what he's done. I know where he's been. but I am still rejoicing in his return. Please come in and join the party. Don't be left out because you can't get over yourself. I don't know if you remember, but a few months ago we looked at this door motif in Scripture, especially in Jesus' stories. Doors are actually somewhat important in Jesus' stories. This idea of the door being shut, and there's this division between those that are on the inside and those that are on the outside. And a door being shut in Jesus' stories is, I mean, I know like a door being shut really isn't in real life that permanent, but in Jesus' stories, it's the idea of permanence, you know. The door is shut. There's actually a story which Jesus said, when somebody shuts the door and somebody's on the outside, and they say, you know, please come out and help me. And the man says, no, the door is shut. I can't come out and help you. And it's like, really? It's just a door. It's not. But there's this image that Jesus gives us of this door being shut, and that there are people on the inside who are trusting Jesus and who are welcomed in to his plan and to his kingdom and to his presence. And then there are people on the outside who, for whatever reason, have refused to be a part of what Jesus wants to do in them. And they're on the outside. And if you look at where the older brother is in this story, he's outside the door. He's outside the door. Don't let unforgiveness and self-righteousness, don't let legalism keep you out, because grace is inviting all of us in. And how that works is, I have to believe. If I believe in grace, if I'm saved by grace, I have to believe in a grace that is big enough to rescue everyone. I have to believe in a grace that is big enough to save the younger brother, because if grace is not big enough to save the younger brother, then grace is not big enough to save me. And this is where the older brother was struggling. This is where Jesus got into. You ever kind of felt a little uncomfortable reading that phrase about where Jesus says, if you don't forgive, then you will not be forgiven? And you're like, doesn't that sound like kind of like works? You know, aren't we saved by grace? What Jesus is saying, it's not like a transaction. Like, if you don't give enough forgiveness in your life, then you won't be forgiven. What Jesus is saying is, if you don't understand my grace to the point where you're able to forgive, then you don't understand my grace to the point where it's able to help you. And that's where the older brother is. He's not outside because he's a jerk, because the younger brother was a jerk too. He's outside because he doesn't get grace. I'm thankful for Anna's testimony. You know, Anna, I said, she's always said that she doesn't have much of a testimony, and I said that I very much disagree. Her story tells us that you can grow up in church, that you can do everything right, that you can follow the rules, that you can grow up in a model home and you can still miss Jesus. You can miss the fact that you still need repentance, because for all of your goodness, for all of your rule keeping, what some of us don't realize, what some of us struggle with, is that we are still outside the door. That we are in danger of being excluded because we are still all a little bit too much in love with ourselves. And that unless Jesus replaces that love that we have for ourselves, unless our love for Jesus replaces that, good, bad, right, wrong, church kid, street kid, we're all in danger of missing God if it's not for Jesus. Back in verse 7, if you remember, Jesus said, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 who need no repentance. And now in this story, as Jesus puts the argument to rest, we find out that those people who are trusting in their righteousness, it's not that they don't need repentance. They don't realize their need for repentance because they are outside. The older brother's outside the door. They just don't recognize it. We all know that the younger brother was too much in love with himself. We all know that he was too much in love with his own desires and his own passions. We all know that he was willing to sacrifice his relationship with the Father to chase after his own desires. But what we don't always see is that the older brother was too much in love with himself too. He was in love with his abilities. He was in love with his own good works. He was in love with his own righteous behavior. And he was in danger of of losing his relationship with the Father because he couldn't let go of his love for his own attempts at righteousness. Don't miss the party. Don't be excluded because you can't get over your own attempts at righteousness. Don't end up missing out because you can't believe in a grace that's big enough to rescue the younger brother. So long story short, I don't know what happened to the older brother because the invitation has just been given. Jesus couldn't tell us what happened to the older brother. Man, I guess he could have because he knew how they were going to respond, but humanly speaking, Jesus couldn't tell us what happened to the older brother because the invitation was just being given. And this morning, I can't tell you what's going to happen to the older brother because the invitation has just been given. So I'd like to pray. We're going to open up the altar, and we're going to find out what happens to the older brother together.